do some show and tell on the 24 volt setup, and it is an 8S. So just like one of my other previous builds, it can also be set up as a 12 volt, so 2P4S. The joy of using 24 volt, the good and bad. The good is that I can, with a 4-aught cable, you can do 3000 watts. In 24 volts, I can do 6000 watts. I can double the capacity of what the cables can handle. When I go 12, 24, 48, I'll be able to double it pretty much. The other, and it works the same, power factor works the same way when you're working with the MPPT, and I'm sure you've looked at the box and you'll see that 12 volt, 24 volt, it doubles again on the 48 volt. So, you know, those high-end boats, the high-end diesel pushers, they're already set up for 24 volt. So hopefully this will eventually trickle down to every travel trailer, truck, camper. We can start taking advantage of 24 volts, and because anything hot past four-aught cables is really hard to manage with. The mindset is using a battery in putting it into a toolbox is as you can see it, it's a modular design. And I've got a high frequency inverter set up on this side, and this one is a low frequency on this. You can spend just a few $100 or you can spend a few $1,000. The course, the use case is where you're going to be at, and hopefully you already have one or two inverters, and you could take advantage of using a case such as this and install it that yourself. And then if you ever want to upgrade, of course you have that. And for me, the mindset for me is the batteries is just like the battery on a cordless tool. Once the I'm bringing the battery to wherever the tools, I would say most times the inverter is going to be set up at your house, and maybe you have a smaller spec one for your boat or your trailer or at work. But it's, you know, the bulk of the price wise within reason is generally the batteries, but some of these inverters of course can cost a lot of money as well, without a doubt, up to, you know, past 10K. Then they're more money than the battery cells that they are. So I'll take this off. So I'm gonna click. This is 60 pounds as opposed to 10 pounds. Battery box, battery in a toolbox case. Screen, I can quickly get a sense of how much power is coming in, how much power is going out. I can get the case history of it. If I want, I can get this set up as a Wi-Fi. There is Bluetooth also with this unit. We have ports on this side. Now, as it is set up as a 24 volt battery, I still have a buck converter inside to take that 24 volt to 12 volt on these side peripherals. So your cigarette lighters and things like that are on this side, USB-C chargers. I've converted that to just 12 volts. Now, so if you have a trailer that's 12 volts, that means you're gonna have to do the same thing. You'll just go through where the batteries are entering into the cab, to the chassis, and you'll just have to have some kind of secondary device outside this. Generally, it's gonna cost you another couple $100, and then you'll be able to, wherever you have a 12 volt outlet throughout your trailer, you'll be able to control, you'll be able to charge that all from one central spot, and regardless, and then you can take advantage of a 24-volt setup. The battery inside this battery setup is fairly, the battery box or the toolbox gives me a little more flexibility in this one. I had a little more space to work with. I'm still confined what I can do, but I did go crazy on the DSR20s that are in here that's being controlled by the Electrodocus, the MPPT. So I have six of them in there. So my mindset there was, if you have smaller 20 amp to 24 amp ones, that means if you have panels on top of the roof, or if you have panels on, like I would really recommend on a stand, on a solar array that's set up on the ground mount, then even though they're pointing in completely different directions, you're not impacting one or the other. You're able to maximize each one because you have a different MPPT for each one. And then you can break that down to size of the trailer, or front or back. And that gives you a lot more flexibility, and you need that when you're out trying to gather as much power as you can. The mindset with this box is we have as much components that I can put inside here, it makes it that easier to take apart and set up. So for us in a northern climate, or if you live in a southern climate where you have to, you can only get the camp, only get the boat for a limited amount of time, and then you gotta take the batteries and everything apart. So the more I can put in here, the easier it is for you to do that. I like the case, either front or this side, and then I can strap that down fairly easy. There's index inside as well, so that, you know, the strap down would go on the one side, and then you can ratchet out. This case, you can stand on, two of me can stand, three of me can stand on this case. It is a very robust case. I can't see why it wouldn't survive down a flight of stairs. And of course, if anything does break and you don't think you can fix it, the cells that are inside there are fairly cocooned. They're sandwiched together. They've got plates of steel and aluminum, steel rods. You're gonna have to do something pretty crazy to damage the cells. Really crazy. It would have to be like a accident or something there that you had this installed, but that's then becomes the least of your concern, because the trailer itself would have to be a complete write-off. So the cells in here, again, they're on that slightly compressed, which gives you those long and many cycle counts. So let's use the best cells that we can, and that'll be the ones that have the 6,000 cycles. So even after all those cycles, it still has 80% of the originally rated power at. So we're talking 15, 20 years. The nice thing is the case will look still good for that many decades. And then if you say there's something new and improved for cells that you want to take advantage of, you don't have to start all over again. It's you'll obviously use all the same components. Wiring's not going to change. The BMSs really won't change. But let's give you that ability to service and repair and update. And not having a sealed container allows you to do that. We have the fuses inside. We have the breakers inside. There's quite a few. I'll give a quick little shot. Hopefully I can remember. But that's what the bulk of the top layer of this battery is. The BMS of the Electrodocus, as I've talked about in the previous builds, is designed by sending an open or closed circuit to either tell the device to turn on or to turn off. So we're not relying on the inability of a typical charger, because it will only read your overall state of charge, not at the individual cells. So by using a port such as this, this will communicate, and I'll show you that port on the other side. I can have it turn on or turn off by that open or closed circuit. And then you can And I'll go into that a little bit when we go to the back of this, but we don't need to have a special charger like that that does that or has that feature to it. You can take anyone, turn it into a smart charger. The signal by the electrodoctors will also tell the inverter, hey, I'm getting too low, please shut off before my cells get damaged. So using LiPo4, not likely we're going to have the thermal runaways, those fires that we're seeing through the electric scooters and things like that. Because of the chemistry, LiPo4 has proven to be one of the safest chemistry that's out there. So that's your, you know, that's just starting foundation. That gives you that first level of security. And if you could put a redundancy BMS, a backup, and it doesn't take that much money, that much time to do it, I don't know why everyone hasn't done that. So let's have a backup so we have the original BMS that controls in the device. But if something goes wrong, the device software, the hardware, down the road after, you know, repeated use, everything usually breaks down. Let's have a backup to the backup. And that's what the secondary BMS, it is a car-based one. It'll handle 500, 800 amps disconnect. It's a relay base, not just MOSFETs. So it is way over engineered for this setup. Are you gonna see typically over 100 amps? I doubt it. When we're running our equipment, we're not seeing anything more than 100 to 150. Kind of give you an idea how you could even use this in not just for home or your trailer, or not just for your trailer or your boat or at work, but this is kind of a setup you could even use at home. Let's say you have two of these and you have your this is only a 4,000 watt, maybe you'll have up to 6,000, 8,000 watt, 24 volt inverter, and then you could use these in parallel, and then when you go, you want to leave for a trip with your trailer, your boat, you can then take one of these instead. Or if you want to take one on tailgate or a picnic or whatever, you know, this is modular. You want to go down, chance of tornadoes or something like that, got to go to the basement, you can physically with two people manage to take that downstairs, and that's, you know, to be in a safe spot. That is manageable. These all-in-ones that have that same kind of capacity, we're 150, 200 pounds, that becomes unmanageable even with two people. So you gotta break it up so that, you know, 80 pounds, 60 pounds, it's manageable. But you're also giving more than a one use case for any device. So you buy to say, hey, I just want this for my trailer, and perfect, but now you want this have for your backup at home during when you're not in the trailer, you have that. This kind of gives you that start into the solar side of things, and you get to dabble your feet into it until you learn. And unfortunately, the only way we learn most times is by trial and error. So just getting a start into something like that, I've learned a lot, what I'm looking for and what I need, for on my personal side of things. The high frequency inverter is what I would been using all the time. My first tents, my first truck campers. I don't need anything that's going to be running over 1,000 watts. Even the microwave is only like at 720 watts. So that high frequency will run that kind of a load. It's not going to run your a skill saw that's a skill saw that uses more than say 15 to 18 amps. You'll hear it chug a little bit. It'll finally catch, but any of those induction loads is a challenge for a high frequency. They are more efficient though. I have, you know, again, I'll have that in the my in my video of my cargo trailer, because that runs my, everything that I just said, like whether it's the fan or our coffee machine or and anything that you convert to just DC power, such as the fridge or the Max Air fan, please do so and take advantage of that. So, okay, let's take you around to the back and give you a sense of more of the peripherals. Okay. So, Anderson Connect, which is so important to not for reverse, not getting reverse polarity. 200 amp breaker. There's the screen color. Over on this one is the XT90. This is the port that the Electrodacus would use for the communication, that open and closed circuit. This here is the 9-pin 8S configuration that you can use for a secondary charge controller. So in this case, I'm charging this 24 volt battery with a 12 volt battery, and this charge controller will control the charge. And if I want to use a traditional charger, an AC charger, it'll of course do that up to 30 amps. But if you wanted to, in the future builds, the MPP part of here, which is down on this one, these are rated for 20 to 24. The newer version will be rated all the way up to 50, but then that limits me. I would probably only have maybe 3 or 4, but then you can put whatever charge controller you want or charger into that, and the Electrodacus would be able to control, say, something like this, which is a 1200 watt. So this one built here will run, say, the microwave, or the, will run this little vacuum cleaner, and you'll kind of hear it chug a little bit, but eventually you'll catch. So this, the peak is at 1500 watts, and then it settles down to about 1100 watts or 45 amps. So even though it's rated at a 3000 watts, for any kind of an inductive load, you're going to be limited to that. My mindset with this little, with this build was that it was going to be outside the trailer, and if we had any moisture, I couldn't bring it underneath the tarp or the canopy, the awning. I didn't want the wires to lead the rain into the connection, so I draped it sort of like a drip rail to it. Now this has no IP rating to it at all, so it's definitely not designed for that, but that's the way I did it, and it did get wet once or twice. But as you can see, how the inverter, the cables come down from the inverter and then into it, and then outputs here. There's fuses inside. Okay, another little Anderson here, and cigarette lighter here. I'm gonna rehook up the charger or the inverter for this. Okay, just a quick peek inside. I put lights inside, so at night you can still deal with the, if there's a fuse that's blowing. Okay. So, if you're at a trade show and you have a pavilion booth, or you're setting things up for tailgate party, you know, the mindset of these batteries. They're built to be able to be moved around and have multiple uses. Okay, so you heard the two clicks. I really do like this screen. So let's say you have that set up in your trailer and then you still want to be able to look at that. You can't quickly do that quick little visual, but by and large, you're going to be using probably the Bluetooth app itself. So I have this turned off. I'm not sure why I have such good success with not getting sparks or shocks with the Anderson connections. Maybe because you're slowly inserting it and it's able to have that, it slows down that inrush. But I've never wrecked an inverter on that for that reason. And then now I can turn that this on. So I should show that other side. All the other sides, you know, these are the ones I was talking about, like the 12 volts. So you put quite a few on this side if you want, of different USB-Cs and Anderson connections, and list goes on, and you kind of get to decide which way you want to go with that. Okay. So I've come up with this. This is higher than 30 amps, but not as high as 50. So, but it still has a 50 amp plug on it. It's not a split phase, it's a single phase. But we're just going to use a 50 amp plug on it. Okay. So then, just traditionally, would use this. So you could have that set up elsewhere. That's the. Also, the nice thing about it, you could have your secondary screen or monitor. Even this can be set up so that it's on an RJ45. You could see the screen elsewhere throughout the trailer or boat. Okay. Simple on or off. Okay, let's bring in our loads. And I'll run the machines. I'm not wearing my microphone this time because I want you to be able to hear the loads run. Maybe best just to put this on the side. That should work just like that. Okay. So that's 1.75 horsepower motor. You're not going to be doing this in your traditional all-in-one. Okay. Yes, you can do like the 4,000 or 6,000 watts, but it's that induction challenge of starting these motors is where we were getting frustrated. I was getting frustrated. When we were flipping the AC breakers. So going with this kind of equipment, we had to run our own batteries, lithium batteries. And when I see these all-in-ones, I'm not gonna be able to run. You know, I'm sure there's some result that they are out there, maybe, but you need such a, you know, that high frequency is for good things and low frequencies is for something like this. So the best thing to do is just to turn this on first, and please listen for the lack or of issues starting it up. It just goes. So now I'm going to try to start these kind of at the same time, okay, with the air conditioner or the air compressor going. Site, you're framing, you're putting down the asphalt roofs, and bang, 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 the air conditioner's on, someone's cutting the saw, and unfortunately sometimes things happen at the same time, but as you can see, you could have two induction loads turn on at the same time, and still the battery and the inverter can handle that kind of load. And just for fun, I'd love to show you what those loads look like on a clamp meter, amps, and let's zero it out. Okay, good. And then I'm gonna try to get this screen to it's as bright as possible as well. Okay. Sorry, it's kind of grainy, but you get the idea. Okay, so 1.1. I've seen it a couple of times because I'm starting to be a jerk and starting the two up at the same time. So 500 amps times 24 volts, it's 10,000 watts. So those induction loads is the challenge. Now I will just briefly add to this video of me doing the input of the solar and just to kind of give you a sense of how easy it is to set up in the